How many do you need for gold?
Five.
Can I advise members that the committee meeting will be broadcast through Parliament buildings and online? Can I advise members that those in the public gallery that they are welcome to use mobile devices as long as they are in airplane mode and all devices are muted. They can't connect to the Assembly Wi-Fi. Password details are available in the gallery rules. It is not permitted to take photographs or record any of the meeting. Can I inform members that the two oral evidence sessions today will be hand-sorted? Agenda item number one, apologies. We have an apology from Trevor Lund. Are there any other further apologies?
No.
Okay. Agenda item number two, draft minutes of the meeting held on the 8th of December 2016. Can I inform members that the draft minutes of the meeting held on the 8th of December are on pages 5 to 11 of the meeting pack? I ask members if they are content that the minutes are a true reflection of the proceedings of the meeting. If so, I indicate and I will sign the minutes. Agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you. Could I move on to agenda item number three, matters arising? Item number one, the Department of Justice response on the January 2017 monitoring round. I remind members that the Department officials attended the meeting on the 8th of December to outline the Department of Justice January 2017 monitoring round position. During the oral evidence session, officials agreed to provide a range of further information. Can I advise members that the Department has provided further information on the backlog of cases following the legal aid dispute, assumptions in relation to pay and price inflation in the context of the draft 2017-18 budget, contractual commitments relevant to the draft budget and the budgetary impact of the decision to keep courthouses open. I think that was Alex that had raised that specific question. The response is at pages 13 to 17 of the meeting pack. I ask members to note the additional information unless any further clarification is required at this stage.
Noted.
Okay. Item number two, response from the Minister of Justice regarding the publication of the report of the working group on fatal abnormality. Can I remind members that following the oral evidence session from the Minister of Justice on the meeting on the 1st of December, the committee agreed to request clarification regarding the intention to publish the report. Can I advise members that the Minister has written indicating that the terms of reference for the working group stipulated that it should report its findings to her and the Health Minister of Health, and it was not asked to prepare a report for publication. The Minister has, however, also highlighted that both she and the Health Minister have already indicated that it would be their intention to publish the document after it has been considered by the Executive. After it had been considered by the Executive, a copy of the correspondence is at page 20 from the meeting pack. Can I ask members to note the position unless any further information is required? Okay. Item number three then, Department of Justice response on the development of a domestic abuse offence and domestic violence disclosure scheme. I remind members that the departmental officials attended the meeting on the 8th of December to provide an update on the position in relation to the development of a domestic abuse offence and the domestic violence disclosure scheme. During the oral evidence session, officials agreed to provide a range of further information. Can I advise members that the department has provided further information on the likely costs and benefits associated with the new offence. Other Northern Ireland legislation that incorporates a similar reasonable person test, statistics on domestic violence incidents and crimes, the evaluation report on the pilot perpetrator programme, and the Bar Council response to the consultation on the proposed new offence. The response is at pages 22 to 85 of the meeting pack. Can I ask members to note the additional information unless any further clarification is sought? Okay, item number four, Department of Justice response on sick absence levels in the Youth Justice Agency and the Northern Ireland Prison Service. I think this is one that you'd raised. Roy, can I remind members that at the meeting on the 8th of December, the committee considered information provided by the Department of Justice on the reasons for sick absence in particular business areas and agreed to request further information on the actions being taken to address the high levels of sick absence in the Youth Justice Agency and the Northern Ireland Prison Service and whether the Vulnerable Exit Scheme had impacted on sick absence levels. Can I advise members that the Department has provided details of how sick absence is managed in both organisations stated that there is no factual evidence that the voluntary exit scheme has impacted on sick absence levels. Responses at page 87 and or 289 of the meeting pack. I ask members if there's further clarification or information sought. Are people content to note?
I think, Mr. Chairman, I would want to hear more what's being done to address, because I mean, there were exceptionally high levels of absenteeism. I mean, I've never heard of such high levels in a public organisation of recent times. We're aware of the problems that there are in the prisons and there's pressures there, but I was surprised with the youth justice system. So I would think we should be seeking further information as to what are seeking an explanation of the reasons being given for absence and what actions are being taken by management to address the issues of concern or reasons for absence. I mean, this will be impacting on many vulnerable young people as well. It's not just about high levels of staff's absence. Is there a problem in the management side, or is there a problem with lack of numbers addressing two big caseloads? I don't know. I think we need further information on this.
Okay. Okay, we'll do that. Action that out. Item number five, then, is Forward Work Programme. Now, can I inform members that the updated Forward Work Programme is for January and February 2017 is at pages 91 to 98 of the meeting pack. I advise members that the oral evidence session on the draft budget 2017 will be scheduled as soon as budget information is available, if it becomes available. Two other oral evidence sessions agreed by the committee are the BASC and the panel of experts on redress have still to be scheduled. Can I ask members to note to the Forward Work Programme for January and February 2017 unless any further information is required? And I will highlight just, members, before we move on, about the committee seminar on the 19th with regards to the keynote speaker Laura Richards on the issue of the stalking review next week. So obviously that will be in the Senate chamber from 1:30 to 3, and then the committee will take place at 3. Okay. Any further issues about the Forward Work Programme?
Just could I ask, Chair, please, just in case there could be an emergency election called before that date, what would the plan be then? Would that seminar still be going ahead?
We're all in a state of flux at the minute. We're looking at a Forward Work Programme that we all probably think is very ambitious at the minute. My view is that we carry on until the Secretary of State puts us in that position.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, the decision of resignation by Deputy First Minister has put him in that position, and the ball is now firmly in his court. So it's when he does make a statement on Monday, if he does make a statement, and what the content of that is, and if he hits any particular button on that particular day. I think only then will we be able to get real concrete.
Now, I know that obviously will interfere with the work of the committee or the meetings and whatever, but I'm just thinking specifically of that seminar. An invited guest speaker. Is there a backup plan?
Well, everything's paid for and invites have gone out. So if the committee isn't here, it can't take place. Everything falls, including this committee. So it'll just basically people have to be phoned and communicated and told that it just had to be cancelled. That would be very unfortunate, of course, heartbreaking, but that's basically where we're at. And unless any of the members around this table can have a positive contribution to play any different part in that, I don't know.
I was just asking the back of that, the individuals have been, are they aware? Or should they make aware that there's a possibility that it may not happen, just to forewarn them, rather than wait till, say, Wednesday or whatever.
Yeah. Just to clarify, the Assembly can operate, the committees can operate, and MLAs are still MLAs until the date of dissolution, which is set in the order that the Secretary of State would have to put through Westminster. So until that order is through and the date's in it, the Assembly can operate digitally.
So is there expectation of being another week at least if it is triggered? Is that it? Or I mean, how fast does that happen at Westminster? That's probably what we're asking about.
I honestly don't know. as I assume they can put it through as quickly as they want, but what that date would be, it's up to him to put the date on it, so it would depend what date he would put on it. The order will specify the date, or set down the date for the election and the date for the dissolution of the Assembly.
So we carry on regardless until that point happens, and hope it doesn't, because the amount of work even this committee has done over the last number of months, the way we've been working through it all together has been very, very good, and it's been a very, very positive committee, so it's been an absolute shame to see us not being able to function. Okay, moving on then. Agenda item number four then is the Criminal Justice Inspection Northern Ireland report on an inspection of the arrangements in place in the PSNI to manage and disclose information and support of the coronial process in Northern Ireland. Can I remind members that the committee agreed at the meeting on the 8th of December to schedule oral evidence sessions in early January with the Chief Inspector and with relevant officials on the findings and recommendations in the Criminal Justice Inspection Northern Ireland report on the arrangements in place in the PSNI to manage and disclose information in support of the legacy inquest. I advise members that Sajini inspectors will attend the meeting to outline the key findings and recommendations in the report. The relevant papers are at pages 100 to 143 of the meeting pack. Could I welcome to the committee Brendan McGuigan, Chief Inspector, William Presley, Inspector, and David McNulty, Inspector, Criminal Justice Inspection Northern Ireland, to the meeting. You're very welcome, gentlemen, as always, to this committee. Can I advise you that the session will be recorded by Hansard and the transcript will be published on the committee website. So I'm sure you're kicking off for us, Brendan. Happy New Year to you all.
Happy New Year.
And without further ado, thank you.
Well, Chair, thank you very much indeed, and members of the committee, for inviting us to speak to you about the findings of this inspection report, which was published last month. By way of background, the inspection was undertaken following a request by the previous Justice Minister in early December 2015. And he had asked me to review the efficiency and the effectiveness of the arrangements in place within the PSNI to manage and disclose information to support the coroner in undertaking legacy inquests. As part of the inspection, Criminal Justice Inspection reviewed the efficiency and effectiveness of the arrangements in place within the police to discharge its responsibilities in support of the coroner in undertaking legacy inquests. It also sought to complement, not repeat, the work undertaken by Lord Justice Weir in reviewing legacy cases and provide greater understanding around the issues impacting on the delivery of an efficient, effective service in support of the coroner. The inspection did not report on individual legacy cases, as we are precluded by law from carrying out inspections of individual cases. We were mindful in undertaking this work that many of the cases involved are controversial, complex, and may involve allegations of collusion. And we recognise the desire of families to gain answers about the circumstances in which their loved ones died to be met quickly as possible. Copies of the inspection report and a short summary document outlining our findings have been provided in advance for your information. Key findings of the inspection were that the PSNI was found to be fulfilling its statutory responsibility to disclose information to the coroner in support of legacy inquests. Through time, the process has become more adversarial than inquisitorial in nature, and the practice of disclosing material is complex, convoluted, and risk-averse. The work by the PSNI and others to provide information to the coroner for inquests is continually interrupted and suffers from fluctuating and competing demands, as there is no mechanism in place by which cases are prioritised. This contributes to delay. There is an urgent need to find an IT solution to ensure information stored in paper files and now obsolete computer systems is preserved for the future. Coronial law in Northern Ireland has evolved since 1959 by virtue of judicial decisions. The matter of legislative review is under consideration by the Department of Justice, and while we accept any updating of legislation will not solve the wide range of issues affecting cases currently in the legacy inquest system, the completion of this project could be beneficial. Coroner's Counsel should become more closely involved in the early stages of the disclosure process. This would help streamline the practice of identifying information relevant to the inquest process for disclosure before redaction of sensitive material occurs. Adequate resources, both human and financial, must be made available at the appropriate level and at each stage of the process. This, in my view, requires political will if outcomes for next of kin in terms of timeliness are to be improved. We have made 7 recommendations to improve current processes and procedures. Five of those recommendations relate to the PSNI, and a further 2 are for others to take forward. Chair, that's all I was proposing to say at this stage, but very happy to take questions. My colleagues, William Priestley, who led the inspection, and David, who supported him, are here to assist me in answering your questions.
Thank you very much, Brendan. I appreciate your concise presentation. It's always appreciative when we're struggling for time. I'll just read any questions. I start at recommendation 7. Start at the back and work forward. I'm awkward like that. You talk about the Coroner's Counsel should be involved in reviewing discovered material to undermine, to determine its potential relevance before it's processed by the Legacy Support Unit with regard to suggested redactions. That sounds as if there's an element of risk involved, maybe, with regards to, well, what should be redacted and what. Is there any risks in that happening? Whilst I see the merits of it happening, I'll come on to that in a wee minute. Is there any risks for anything there, whether it be national security or privacy?
Well, Chair, it's important that I say at the outset that the coroner sees everything. There is no material that the coroner doesn't see. But what the coroner has to decide upon is in terms of what is released out into the public domain and onward to families. And in helping them do that, the police initially conduct the research to find the relevant material, and then will propose redactions. There then follows a very convoluted process before it eventually gets back to the coroner for him or her to make that final decision. And that's why I'm saying to you, it's very risk averse, but we are talking about a lot of information, lots and lots of information on the troubles here. The difficulty has been that some of the material that has been involved in some of these coronial inquests, families have challenged to say, but this information is in the public domain, and it may well be. The difficulty for the police is that, you know, they have that information recorded as secret or confidential or whatever. That was when it was placed in storage. And subsequently, that may well have appeared in publications, newspapers, and indeed some of the investigative journal publications that have occurred over the years. And so, you know, there's a lack of trust around this, because there's a belief then that the police somehow are withholding information, but they have and I'm sure they will explain, neither confirm nor deny when they're presented with this information, especially if it relates to the provision of intelligence. So it's a complex process, and I suppose what we were saying was, well, look, you know, because in the past it's been problematic in terms of, well, what is the scope and relevance of the material that is required for this inquest? And I think the initiative by the Lord Chief Justice, by appointing some senior judges to act as coroners in complex cases, was really a substantial initiative on his part, because these are difficult issues. And it takes sometimes somebody of that stature and judicial experience to indicate to the council for both families and victims and council for the police or council for the coroner in terms of what actually is going to happen in this particular case and what information is relevant in this particular case. In the past, and certainly on some of the cases that we reviewed, there were tombs of material, unbelievable amounts of material that had been subject to the disclosure process, substantial amounts of which had been redacted. There was repeat information in it, and on each occasion it was redacted in different forms. We could see that it was very complex and it had grown organically into almost like this monster that now needs to be taken hold of. It needs to be led, and so one of the main recommendations was what would be really helpful to the police researchers, and the police researchers are it's a lawyer-led team of police staff. There are no actual police officers involved in it. Many of these staff are very well qualified in terms of what it is that they should and should not be disclosing. But if our view was, if Coroner's Counsel was up close to the disclosure process, they could be advising the police about what was relevant and indeed the scope of the particular material that should be disclosed in the first instance. Now, ultimately, that will be a decision for the coroner. But before you start to go through thousands and thousands of pages of documents and consider each one of them as to what needs to be redacted, kept, so that you're not identifying individuals, etc., that's a really time-consuming process. And given that it goes through a series of sieves before it came back to the coroner, it adds a tremendous amount of time into the overall process. So small wonder that you have many of these cases that have been around now for a substantial period of time. So we believe that getting the Coroner's Counsel close to the point of discovery and narrowing the amount of material that needs to be considered for redaction would be a really big improvement.
Obviously, time is money. Apart from the fact that it's just not acceptable to take so much time, but I take it, can we take it as automatic that there'll be, if this recommendation 7 was to take place, there'd be a cost savings. There might be a cost burden moving, maybe moving to the coroner's council rather than PSNI. I don't know. What's your thoughts on a cost burden moving?
Well, certainly what we could identify was that, you know, some of the systems and paper files that the police have to research are deteriorating by the day. And each time they're accessed, actually, their legibility, etc., reduces. What we're saying is, you know, there needs to be an investment here so that this information is recorded, so that it isn't lost. It doesn't disappear from the scene completely. And given that some of this material is now 40 to 50 year olds, it's not like what you're dealing with at the minute, where you can open a file on a computer system and lock it in there. Some of these are retained on microfiche and microfilm, and for those in the digital era, they probably think that stuff went out with the ARC, but actually that's what was about at the time when the police were recording this information. It is deteriorating. There needs to be an investment there so that this material is retained and capable of research and support the coroner as we move forward. Now, there's lots of other things, and I'm sure you've all seen the newsreel footage of the storage capacity at Sea Park and the murder archives and how that information is retrieved. That's a separate issue. The Lord Chief Justice has also identified that he will require the archiving of material, because you know many of these things and much of the material that's disclosed in one case may well be relevant in another. And so rather than going right back through the whole process of having to research and all the rest, actually some of this material, because some of these cases are linked. So, and you know, it may not be heard for a couple of years' time, but the very fact that you have distilled this information, you've retained it on researchable systems that actually can more effectively support the coronial process.
With regards to the recommendation four, with the volume and type of material sent to the Crown Solicitor's Office for final checking, that strikes me as somewhere there's a someone, staff member of PSNI, just saying, right, all of that, pump it all together and send it all to the Crown Solicitor's Office, because it might save time for them having, instead of having to sift through, just send it all. Is that the case, or am I just being far too simplistic? Or is your experience the other way, where they want to look through everything to see what's in it and then send it all in a mountain of paper?
Well, certainly when we visited the Crown Solicitor's Office, and as you approach the offices of the various solicitors, you will see increasing numbers of file cabinets, locked file cabinets, and that contains information that has been passed to them by the Legacy Support Unit that has already been processed by the police for initial consideration by the Crown Solicitor's Office. And this is what we talk about, actually. Resourcing one area of this process isn't going to resolve it for you, you know, because there only are four solicitors in the Crown Solicitor's Office who are dealing with these legacy inquests. So despite the fact that you have over 20 in the police researching this information, generating this material, there are only four lawyers in the Crown Solicitor's Office. And the Crown Solicitor's Office is there really to protect departments, because all departments of government, and if you understand that actually not only do the police provide information to the coroner, but the Ministry of Defence, the Home Office, the Foreign Office, the Cabinet Office, all have responsibilities to deliver information in particular cases to the coroner. So, and my understanding of this is that any department that doesn't seek and obtain legal advice before releasing material into the public domain, and there is a problem, well then it falls to the individual organisation to accept that responsibility. So it's a service that is available there. But what we were saying was, well, look, you know, it might help if you were reducing the amount of irrelevant material that they're having to consider. And so that only that material that's really pertinent, and indeed we would have gone further, and I have gone further in the report to say, well, actually, you know, because there are so many lawyers involved at every part of this process, you could afford to be a bit more risk averse in relation, or less risk averse about this, and actually accept that perhaps only that material that is sensitive, really sensitive to the state, should be reviewed by the Crown Solicitor's Office. You know, and that's, I suppose, for us, a belief that in the competence of the lawyers and legal staff who are involved in this process. That's not to say that mistakes can't happen, because they can. And obviously, the final responsibility in this is that the police are reluctant to release information that can identify individuals that may be subject to some form of intimidation or retribution or whatever. It would be wrong to do that. So they have considerations around the safety of individuals, as indeed does the coroner. When, you know, because Article 2 now of the European Human Rights Act really was encouraging coroners to provide as much information as they could to the families of victims, so that they could really understand how it was and what circumstances and who was responsible, if anyone, for the death of their loved ones.
You sprinkle throughout the report about the how the legacy inquests and coroner's service has become much more adversarial. Forgive me, because don't have that much experience in that side of the judicial system compared to the ordinary court. And you'll understand why it's adversarial in an ordinary court.
Yes.
Coroners will be different, I understand. Why do you think it has become adversarial? And is it the injection of solicitors and barristers? And if that is the case, how do we fix it?
Well, the stakes have been raised. That's the reality of it. You know, many of the original inquests took place in the early 70s and 80s. Unfortunately, when the levels of deaths in Northern Ireland was particularly high, where the initial police investigation might have been very sparse, if at all, actually. In the early 70s, it may well have been, you know, especially deaths where soldiers were involved. It may well, the original inquiries may well have been conducted by army personnel in the form of special investigation teams within the military police, and then passing that information on to the RUC at that stage. Obviously, it became more sophisticated in the 80s and 90s and 2000s, etc. But then, with the onset of the Article 2 and some high-profile cases, that really started to dictate how coroners would have to respond, not only in Northern Ireland, but actually much wider. I mean, some of the cases that emanated here are influencing how coroners' courts are conducted in other jurisdictions. So so some of the case law here is entirely relevant. But what happened then was that once you started up the stakes, once you started to ask more deep and probing questions, then the reality of it was that people said, well, why do you want to ask this? So you could start to see the adversarial nature of it starting to increase, whereas the inquisitorial nature of inquests in the past was really who, how, where, when. Those were the questions that the coroner was essentially interested in. But now those questions posed by families may well say, well, actually, did someone do something about this? Did someone have information about this that could have stopped this? You know, the questions then started to increase, and then allegations in some of these controversial cases, and obviously the involvement of senior counsel in these cases then really started to up the ante, and I suppose then the whole system has reacted, and as a result then you have the situation that you have today.
You know, if the level of challenge, for want of a better word, has been upped over the years, become more detailed and how can the coroner affect that to try and bring it back? It strikes me that he won't be able to, even though he is, or she is the coroner, and there to control the... How do they affect that to bring it back into something that might be more manageable, if that's a phrase that I can use?
Yeah. Well, firstly, I would have to say I have great faith in our judiciary in Northern Ireland, when the Lord Chief Justice took over superintendence of the coroner's courts, and he accepted the responsibility, the international responsibilities that he now had in terms of ensuring that these cases were heard in a timely fashion and that the questions were answered. He's in breach of European legislation as it sits at the minute because of the length of time some of these cases have taken. When he said he would do that, when he said he would appoint senior judges to act as coroners so that the proceedings could be conducted. And certainly my observations over the last period of time is that in those cases where senior judges have taken control and are dealing with complex, convoluted issues, actually those cases are progressing. And there is something about who's in charge within the court, and you know, judges don't have any problem when it comes to criminal court cases, high court cases, and believe you me, in coroner's court cases now where you have high court judges sitting, that will be exactly the same. And there is a feeling that, and certainly some of the observations and some of the feedback from even from the police themselves to us was that when there was this sense of in control, we know where we're going, there needs to be a collaborative approach between the coroner's council and the police. Actually, they are delivering more material and cases are being progressed. But unfortunately then, I you know, like everyone else, we heard one of the High Court judges talking about the one of the cases there in December, when families were asking, well, when might we hear this? And he said, well, actually, it is an issue for us because we don't have the resources now to be able to put dates on when this might actually be heard. But that's notwithstanding the fact that I know that that within the police and within the Crown Solicitor's Office, when they're working collaboratively together to try and deliver a product to the coroner so that the cases can be progressed, that actually that is working. It is working.
Okay. Any other members seek to ask questions? Okay. We seem to be content. Right, you want, sorry, go ahead.
You indicated that there's a risk aversion. How do you weigh in the risks of information going into the public domain which may actually endanger individuals?
Well, I do accept that that is a risk. However, you know, it's about we put faith in the systems and processes, and you know, unfortunately, there's always an element of risk with all of this stuff about what goes into the public domain, what should do. I believe that, you know, if there was the screening and the reducing the amount of material that needs to be considered, then there is less chances because you're looking at much less information, and you can really go over each line and word and ensure that that, you know, only the relevant material is being redacted and then subsequently released to families.
Okay, Claire.
Thank you. Just like to ask, are you aware of any other area where the disclosure of information is such an inconsistent or messy process outside of the legacy cases? Is this a normal practice in the judiciary system?
Well, disclosure generally is the responsibility for disclosure probably rests with the prosecution service. It's about ensuring that they, you know, in criminal cases, it's about ensuring that there's fair play here, that if the police had material that might be beneficial to the defence, that information is made available to the defence. It's just... But essentially that is down to the prosecutor. The people with responsibility for revealing that information to the prosecutor are the police. But ultimately it's a kind of a legal, it's between lawyers more or less, you know, in terms of what's relevant, what's not relevant. And then eventually a disclosure judge making decisions about what is actually should be released to the defence or whatever, especially when it comes to perhaps national security issues or whatever. To be honest with you, we tried to see, is there anywhere else experiencing these sort of problems? And no. When we looked at Hillsborough, and that worked extremely well, but we weren't talking about, you know, I suppose Hillsborough wasn't about collusion. It was, well, collusion in the sense of cover-ups and whatnot, but it didn't really deal with national security issues. The closest one to it was probably the 7/7 bombings in London, and that inquest was chaired by none other than Lady Justice Hallett. So a High Court judge sitting and ensuring that the proceedings, that it delivered what it was required to do. So that was really the closest we could get. There was no other jurisdiction, unfortunately, having to face what we're facing here.
Yep, go ahead.
Just, Brendan, thank you. I mean, it's interesting, it's fascinating as well. I mean, we are coming out and we are in post-conflict, and that conflict has lasted for a long, long time. And we all know that a small snippet of intelligence from 1972 can fit into a puzzle in 1982, which can name an individual in 1992. And therefore, I think it can be viewed possibly, and it's more of a statement, possibly unfair to say that maybe the PSNI are being risk-averse, because maybe they just understand that intelligence chain which they're trying to cover. So what many people would probably think is a piece of information which means nothing is actually quite important when you put it in the jigsaw, which makes up an intelligence picture. And I can see why you find no jurisdiction similar to the difficulties that you're talking about, because, you know, there's very few jurisdictions that have just gone through a 30 years issue like this. So I don't envy you, and agree with an awful lot of what you're saying, and some of the processes are slightly beyond me, but I don't fully understand it in many ways. You know, when you talk about the Coroner's Council looking at stuff before it's redacted and saying that piece of information is useful, and then giving it back to the police, and the police say, yes, it is useful, but I'm going to have to redact that piece. Is that a possibility?
Well, the police have to make it at the minute. They have to take a decision in relation to that. But, you know, the very fact that you had Coroner's Council working with the police, you know, you would imagine that, you know, the Coroner's Council was saying, well, that could be redacted there, you know. And you know, you're shortcutting what is now a really lengthy process. And we just felt that actually you could tighten this up considerably. But, you know, once again, that needs, you need a situation where you do have full-time coroner's counsel. We believe that, you know, because at the minute, the way the Northern Ireland Bar operates at the minute, that, you know, you could have a coroner's counsel operating for the coroner in this case and for the family in another case. And you could have them going off to do criminal work. Yeah. And not available for a number of days, and we're going, well, look, you know, if you're serious about trying to get these cases through, then it really needs to be an effort, and that might well be about the coroner employing full-time counsel to enable the process to deliver. And what we felt was that, you know, we do actually believe that there's a lot of lawyers involved in this process on behalf of the police, on behalf of the Crown Solicitor's Office, on behalf of the families, and on behalf of the coroner. Surely to God, we can sort this out.
Yeah, and I agree, sorry, Chair. And I agree, you know, in many ways what you say. I think it's that business about the PSNI own that risk when they're giving out information. They own that risk and the consequences of that risk that they own, you know. I can understand when you say that they may be too risk-averse, but I do believe also that you know, after what we've gone through over this last years, that actually that risk is very still real today.
And I don't disagree with you, but unfortunately, the experience of some of the families is that information that currently gets redacted and raised with them, and they're able to refer to the fact that it was... that was in Lost Lives, or that was in some other publication, or that was... Now, you know, and the police are in an unenviable situation, of course, where they neither claim or deny. That's their policy, because that material, when it was originally, set in storage, actually had a confidential or a secret marking on it. And until, you know, that changes, it's going to be very, very difficult to.
There'll be many times when there's something published, you know, whilst there's the rigours of the law and defamation and everything else, libel, there's things that could well be published that, well, are published that may not be factual, may be part factual, may not be factual at all. So to release documents on the sense that it has already been put out in the public domain won't necessarily cut it, because of the fact, well, look, nobody has proven that fact or that line or that paragraph in a book or in a publication or in a paper even. Yeah. So there is that responsibility.
I think go back to something just that Brendan said earlier, which was ultimately the decision does still rest with the coroner.
Yeah.
who sees all material. and suggested redactions, so the coroner sees everything and then makes that decision. So that fail-safe will still be in place, yeah. And so it should.
Claire, you want to come in for
it? Yeah, just want to go back to the issue of the legislative review or the need for case law as well, and just you highlight here that that you acknowledge that the department are currently looking at that. Have you any idea where they are on that at the minute?
No, I don't.
Can ask them. No.
Just one point, it was in my head I asked just before Doug rightly took us down that route. Who is ultimately the responsibility to make the decision of what to disclose and what to redact?
The coroner. End of story. The coroner has ultimate responsibility, even on secret information from the security services, national security issues. The coroner will consider and will make a judgment call in terms of whether that should be released or not.
You said earlier that the coroner sees everything.
Yes.
Not to get into Rumsfeld, but there's unknowns. They're unknown unknowns. All of this. Now, if we've had a conflict for 30 years and there has been intelligence actions which have saved many, many lives throughout the years, how does the coroner get confidence that he can see everything? Or she can see everything? Or the office, sorry. I keep falling out of the polls.
Well, I could say to you it's about the integrity of the individuals involved in the process, the fact that, you know, this is a lawyer-led process, really, you know, although the police will be here and respond to it, they ultimately own this responsibility. But all of those lawyers operate to a professional code of conduct, you know, and that's what our legal system is based on, that we do expect them to operate in a way and to a standard that gives us reassurance that our legal system is safe in their hands.
And I probably am making this out to be too simplistic, it's probably my ignorance, but so when the coroner or anyone, solicitor acting on behalf of someone, or barrister acting on behalf of someone, asks for or requests information to be disclosed, is it as simple as they saying you want everything and they get it, or do they have to be specific about what they're actually asking for?
Well, once again, this, unlike a criminal court, you know, where the judge will listen to various sides of the argument, and the coroner may well do that as well, but actually the coroner is in ultimate control here. Ultimate control. I will decide the scope and relevance of the material that needs to be researched, but that sometimes needs an experienced legal figure, which, you know, in some of our cases now, we do have senior legal figures who will make those determinations around the scope and relevance so that you're not going off down cul-de-sacs and going in the wrong direction. They're in charge. They're there. Everyone is there to service their needs so that they can answer the questions that the families want.
Any further questions?
I've got to say, can I just confirm something? Does that mean the coroner owns the risk? So if the coroner says that I feel this piece of information should be released, not realising that piece of information fits in, does he own that risk?
Well,
if that results in something happening, you know, somebody being targeted, injury, attack, murder, does he own that risk?
Well, ultimately he would do, and provided that you know, that is pointed out to the coroner,
yeah.
And that's the role of the legacy support unit and the police and his own counsel in terms of, but ultimately the decisions will rest ultimately with the coroner.
Yeah, and CSO would obviously have an input into that as well as to the suggested redactions going forward to the coroner.
Thank you.
And again, this is fascinating because whilst you might own the risk, that risk might never be realised to have been the effect or the impact on something that happens 2 years down the line.
That's quite right. And for instance, the police are holding, not exclusively, but hold a lot of material on behalf of the Ministry of Defence, you know, probably earlier MOD records and stuff like that. But they have to seek, firstly, the permission of the Ministry of Defence that they can release the information. So hence my comments to you that actually resourcing one part of this process isn't the answer to it. Actually, to enable it to function properly, you've got to ensure that every part of it is resourced adequately so that it can work in a seamless fashion.
Resourced and dedicated to
you. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, any further questions? Okay, thank you very much. It's been a very, very good and useful session.
Thank you, Chair.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for your report.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay, members. Moving on then, agenda number 5, again, Criminal Justice Inspection Northern Ireland report on an inspection of the arrangements in place to the PSNI to manage and disclose information in support of the coronial process in Northern Ireland. Advise members that the PSNI and Northern Ireland Courts and Tribunal Service officials are now will now attend to discuss the findings and recommendations of the CGNA report. Can I welcome to the committee Assistant Chief Constable Mark Hamilton, PSNI, Colin Stafford, Head of Legacy Unit, PSNI, Peter Looney, Head of Court Operations, Northern Ireland Courts and Tribunal Service, and Mandy Mackay, Business Manager of Legacy and Informal Services, Northern Ireland Courts and Tribunal Service. You're very welcome to the meeting, everyone.
Thank you.
I advise you that the session will be recorded by Hansard and the transcript will be published on the committee web page. Can I invite ACC Hamilton and Peter Looney to outline the PSNI and the court, Northern Ireland Courts and Tribunal Services response to the findings and the recommendations in the report? Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you for the invitation to speak to the committee. I am joined today by my colleague Colin Stafford, who runs our Legacy Support Unit. He's a lawyer, and many of those technical questions that the committee have been raising, this gentleman here has been dealing with them specifically over the last 10 years, so he's well placed to answer all the technical questions. I answer for Legacy for the Chief Constable. Colin's department, however, does sit separately to mine. He sits within our legal support, our legal branch. Otherwise provide sort of daily support to him from Chief Officer's perspective. Firstly, we welcome the report and the challenges laid down. We did work closely with the inspectors to ensure that they had full exposure to our systems and our processes. And we're grateful for the sort of very forensic examination that has taken place, and it's important to learn from it. I do recognise that there has been much criticism in the public arena of the PSNI in respect of delay in inquests. We have worked very hard to improve our performance and our processes whilst upholding our duty to disclose and our responsibilities under the European Convention on Human Rights. We do want the public, families and witnesses to have confidence in the system and how we administer our part of the process. This year we achieved most of the deadlines set for us in the year past, and we feel we are well placed to manage the inquest schedule for this year, 2017. And as I say, we're grateful for Sir Jenny for observations, and it's important that we objectively challenge ourselves to bring further improvements based upon what Sir Jenny has said. We are actively considering these recommendations, and we will collaborate with the court service to establish the best way to improve the processes and move forward. I recognise and know that there is room for improvement, and I'm keen to effect change. I also welcome the recognition that this is a complex area of work and that the PSNI has been and is discharging its statutory duties. Sort of specifically, the report does identify that the PSNI may be too risk averse in some areas of work. As outlined by Brendan, we are led by the coroner in this process. Every piece of work we do has full sight of the coroner and has the full approval of the coroner, and that the coroner is the final decision maker. Therefore, in our appetite for risk, whilst we are very willing to enter into that debate, we would seek to be guided and led by the coroner and by the legal processes in any change to our appetite for risk. And in that appetite for risk, there is always the criticism that if we decide early in the process that something's relevant or not relevant, that actually then we could be accused of withholding information. And our process is to make sure that we are not accused of that information goes out And then that the coroner and the legal system decide then how that is put into the public arena or not. But it is complex and difficult, and there are competing rights under the European Convention between the right to privacy, the right to life, and also then the demands of the European Convention in providing an open and effective investigation into people's deaths and providing answers to families, which I completely respect. Any family has the right to have that. I would expect it myself, and I fully and utterly support it. Some of the recommendations made by Sejini will require additional funds to allow investment in personnel or infrastructure. We have spent and continue to spend a lot of main grant money on the inquest process and in servicing the entire legacy framework in Northern Ireland. It will probably cost us about £10 million next year in entirety across the whole of the legacy framework. We're engaged in legacy investigations, legacy litigation, legacy inquests. So even sitting alongside this work, you know, we have 400 litigations to be dealing with, over 20 judicial reviews, and obviously then there are the outstanding homicides that are being, the review process of which started many years ago and which is continuing. The Chief Constable has stated on many occasions that he doesn't feel that the current coronial processes are quite fit for purpose for what we're asking it to do at the minute in terms of these legacy inquests. We welcome the recognition and report that decisions on prioritisation of cases and relevance of material would greatly assist in speeding these processes up. We welcome that. That is for others, though, to decide how that happens. We will respond to that. The Chief Constable fully supports the proposals of the Lord Chief Justice just over a year ago to introduce new processes to legacy systems. These processes will require additional funds, and we would support the call for additional funds. And that does impact heavily upon the ability to bring in new IT, new people, new processes. And I don't mean to be polemic, but the longer that goes on, the longer it takes them to get these processes started and pushed forward. However, even in the absence of those changes or reforms, we are fully committed and we have dedicated people to processing this as quickly, as reasonably, as effectively we can. And I say, I welcome the report. We'll work through with the court service and the recommendations. I'm happy to take any questions that you would then have, Chair.
Okay. Thank you, Chair. Like Mark, I'm grateful for the opportunity to discuss with the committee today our initial thinking on the Criminal Justice Inspection's report on relation to disclosure for the coronial process. The report follows careful analysis by Sejini colleagues, and it's a welcome contribution, not least because it provides reassurance that the PSNI is fulfilling its statutory obligation to disclose material to the coroner service. Nevertheless, it is clear from the report that improvements in disclosure arrangements can be made. It's crucial that all justice bodies involved in the inquest process work collaboratively to ensure effective implementation of all the recommendations. The police and the Courts and Tribunals Service are considering how best to take the recommendations forward and will report further to the committee and the policing board on this in due course. In the interim, the committee will wish to know a few areas where progress is already being made. We're currently developing and progressing a focused case management approach. As recognised in the report, sensitive materials which involve a public interest immunity claim are regularly provided to Coroner's Counsel at an early stage for a determination as to potential relevance. Counsel to the coroner is therefore facilitated to view the papers and advise on the extent to which the materials are potentially relevant before the materials are then marked with proposed redactions. This process is working well, and therefore this system could be introduced more widely in line with Recommendation 7 in legacy cases. New procedures have recently been implemented for disclosure management and shared with key partners and stakeholders, including the police. Further refinement of these procedures will be informed by the recommendations in this report. That's really all I need to say. I mean, Mark has covered a lot of where we are already. I hope you found the remarks useful and, again, happy to take questions. We'll also be happy to arrange for the committee to be kept up to date with implementation of the recommendations as we move them along.
Okay, thank you both Peter and Mark for your presentation and your concise nature. Thank you. Always push for time. I suppose it's really a question. You obviously had the benefit of hearing the Sejini give us presentation and answer the questions. Seven recommendations is not necessarily a lengthy report and filled with multiple recommendations. So you've seven recommendations. Both organisations, whilst you welcome them all, do you actually accept them all in full?
Sure. At this point, no, we haven't fully accepted all the recommendations, because I think we do have to work through some of the nuances around the issues about, for example, around risk appetite. I don't think we can just say, well, we accept that we should give less material to be considered for disclosure. I think that's a huge issue for us. Another one, for instance, is this issue about material that has secret material, sensitive material that has made its way into the public domain through unofficial channels. And Colin here can clarify this, but my understanding of our position is that if a secret document or a sensitive piece of material in the original document is disclosed openly into the public domain, then we wouldn't be seeking, the actual document there is, we generally don't seek to redact that, but rumours, speculation, people's commentaries in books, then we do apply the principle of neither confirm nor deny that. And we wouldn't want to get to a stage whereby people felt that if they did leak information into the public arena, that we would then take a position that we would not seek to withhold it or redact it. I can't accept, however, how kind of, in some respects, how this makes no sense to members of the public. But I cannot necessarily accept publicly every comment made by an ex-soldier, ex-police officer, ex-intelligence person, or whoever who has decided to talk about something in the public arena. However, if something is clearly, a physical document is clearly leaked and is in the public arena, then, of course, then it would not be sensible then to try and do that if it's.
Colin, would you be able to comment on that?
Yeah, the only exception to that would be obviously the coroner. May want to review that document. The document may have gone into the public domain maybe 15, 20 years ago. And because the Article 2 issue may be more pertinent now, because it's become an issue now, the coroner himself or herself may indicate there may be an Article 2 risk about someone's name and say, look, for the purposes of the inquest that I'm running, I want to protect that name. But certainly from the PSNI point of view, if the material has gone into the public domain, we will not seek to protect it.
Again, just on the specific recommendations about building an admin unit and also then additional IT, we did have a bit of a to and fro with the inspector around the admin unit, because Colin's people were of the view that intimate knowledge of the case and actually case papers is fundamental to this. Brendan's people have taken a very pragmatic approach, where actually just saying that people shouldn't be having to photocopy their own work. And I think there's strength to both sides of that, and we're by no means going to die in a ditch over it. All I would say is, we've 400 staff left last year on the voluntary exit scheme. The main grant for the police service has diminished by nearly a quarter of a billion in the last 5 years. We are, with respect, waiting for our settlement for next year, anticipating more cuts. So it's extremely difficult for me to commit any additional resources in any parts of our business at the minute. Similarly for IT, with capital budgets being dramatically reduced over the last number of years, we have been scoping out new IT systems for Legacy as a whole, and we've done a lot of work on this. We have been waiting to see if additional funding would be available through whatever Legacy framework might be agreed. We've gone ahead to replace one IT system at the minute, which holds very sensitive material, which is in danger of collapse. So we've gone ahead and done that. We're putting investment into that, and we've engaged with the partner agencies who need the material around that. But so it's not that we are not accepting the recommendations, Chair. We just have to work through the fine tuning of them, and certainly anything that we feel is actually within the gift of the coroner to decide upon relevance or prioritisation or risk appetite is something that I think we would have to defer to the coroner. I think it does link to the last two recommendations about structural reform, prioritisation and relevance, and it needs to be almost a package to get all these things moved forward together. So when I say I welcome it, I do welcome it, but it's going to be very difficult just to pick off one of these individual cases.
I'm going to put you in hold, Peter, if you don't mind, because I want to pursue a line of questioning with Mark, and I'll come back to ask you the question about recommendations. That sounds very cumbersome and time-consuming, but it won't be. Mark, on that specific... So, to be clear, is it simple for you as to put it down as we accept recommendations 2 and 3, but not 4 and 5? Or is it more complicated than that, because some...
No, I think in deference to the chair and to the committee, you know, this report came in just before Christmas. Yeah. We haven't had a full meeting yet, with the court service about this, so I wouldn't want to be as blunt as that. I think there's elements of all the recommendations that I'm going to try and achieve. I just can't say that I can...
That's fair enough.
I'm standing on the fence here a bit, but we're not finally resolved on it.
Well, the time is the big factor here, and of course we had that big event called Christmas, so I understand. With regards to funding, because you talked about, well, some of these, whilst we welcome them, they won't be realised unless there's funding. Does the PSNI have a figure? And if you were giving a part or the amount of that money, on what recommendation would you spend the money on? Where would you throw the money?
My instinctive response is probably into IT. I mean, there is, with the prospect of alternative mechanisms as well for legacy investigations as well, we're sitting there with 62 million pages of intelligence documents in various formats. Murder files relating to 3,200 plus deaths between 1969 and 1997, and then deaths post that period as well. So we have masses of material, some of it on various formats. So I think if there was capital investment and revenue investment into systems that could speed things up. So even the system we're buying at the minute for one of our databases, we've asked for a new search engine into it to try and make stuff more instantly retrievable. But even that, we have to do carefully, because even in migrating systems, Chair, we have to be careful that we don't lose material, that there's accountability and transparency about the movement of material from one format to another, so that there's no accusations that anything has been removed or changed. But instinctively, that would be where I would put it. Colin probably might say to me, more people, Mark, but maybe if you want to answer for yourself as the head of your department.
Well, I think, Chair, in terms of taking this forward, and certainly the Lord Chief Justice's plan to move Legacy Inquest over a five-year period, I think it was envisaged that more people would be required all around. That's in terms of with the coronial team, they would require more people to move these inquests over a five-year period. Likewise, ourselves, to be able to feed the coronial team, we would need to work in this collaborative way to be able to match the demands that would be coming to us and to be able to redact and disclose materials. So indeed, it would be extra people, without a question of doubt.
And that would be extra people right across the system, because you wouldn't want to create an hourglass where there's this bit in the middle.
Well, you always get bottlenecks in some of this, because I think there was a question earlier, and there's two parts of this process, the disclosure process. There's the part, and I use the terms, and they're quite unhelpful terms, but there's the non-sensitive disclosure. That's the investigative-type materials, the previous inquest materials, the open-source materials. Yeah. That's the material we have researchers who are non-sensitive researchers. Gather those materials and disclose them to the coroner. You also then have the sensitive materials, that's secret, top secret materials, which is dealt with in different systems by different people, different researchers. So that adds to the complexity of the whole process. And I think within the two processes, there are different ways in which the material is actually disclosed to the coroner. Now, the key point is the coroner sees everything. That's the key point. But in terms of the non-sensitive process, our people will research and gather that material. And to give you an idea and give you a flavour, you could have some of this investigative material could go into maybe 35, 36 lever arch files of material. That's roughly speaking, maybe 15, 20,000 pages. Those 15, 20,000 pages have to be gone through page by page, line by line, for Article 2 and Article 8 redactions. What our people do is they mark suggested redactions, which the coroner can view and either agree or disagree with those redactions. And we enter into a collaboration with the coroner's team on food of queries they have, and maybe in some of the folders regarding those redactions. And we would be asked for our rationale as to why we're applying an Article 2 redaction there or wherever. The difference with the sensitive approach The coroner's counsel will be invited to CPARC to view sensitive materials that have been collected in relation to whatever the inquest is. The coroner's counsel will view those materials and will deem them relevant or not, potentially relevant or not, for the purpose of the inquest. Once the coroner's counsel does that, we take those materials away. We mark them then for issues of national security, public interest immunity. They'll be put forward for a national security certificate at some point in time. The key point with all of this process is it goes through a number of stages, whereby it'll be approved by the Chief Constable, that is the National Security PI, will be approved by the Chief Constable. It'll then be moved to either the Minister of State or the Secretary of State, who will then certify on foot of the issues that have been sought to be redacted on those grounds. It will then come back to the coroner, where the coroner will have a PII hearing, where the coroner once again will review the same materials with the redactions and with the certificate from the minister, and will then either confirm that the coroner agrees with those redactions or does not agree with the redactions. And so you can see it's a multi-phase where there are many eyes over the stages of the documents, and those are the sensitive documents I'm talking about. The difficulty, I think, coming back to, you know, the process being overburdened is going back to the nonsensical process. What the coroner doesn't do at this point is come at an early stage with the nonsensical materials and view those materials before we mark them up for suggested redactions. We do that as an initial stage, which means those documents then will go to the coroner, and the coroner will then view them with the redactions already in place, the suggested redactions in place. Now, that takes us a considerable period of time. It'll take the coroner's team a considerable period of time because of the volume that I've alluded to. You know, 35, 36 folders of these materials, that takes a huge amount of time. And may I say as well, and I think it's useful to say this, in terms of those 35, 36 volumes, one of our researchers, you know, goes along, researches all this material. It isn't sitting in nicely stacked piles of very, very neatly processed paper. It's, you know, crumpled paper, paper clips. So it all has to be maybe unclipped and put into an order, put into a process. It maybe even has to be photocopied before it can actually be scanned onto a system because of the state of the paper. So there's no doubt there's a convoluted process because you're dealing with the volume of material that you're dealing with and because of the state and the nature of the material at particular times. I hope maybe that sort of explains to some degree the process that actually takes place.
That's very, very helpful to run that through us. You know, we're not experts in everything, and especially in all this. I'll part you guys, and with regards to recommendations, purely seven recommendations, what's your thought process on, and again, the same condition with regards to the time that you've had to look at this applies, but what's your thoughts on the seven recommendations?
The recommendation that's obviously of most relevance to us is number seven, which is around the disclosure processes, and I think it's very clear from what Brendan and Colin Mark have said that, I mean, it is a cumbersome and time-consuming process by necessity because of the complexity of the material, because of the volume of the material, and I think anything that can be done to ease that burden is to be welcomed. The scope for council to be involved at an earlier stage will ultimately be for the coroner to decide, but it's certainly something we'd be keen to explore. I think that if we can get, I think disclosure will ultimately be an iterative process. I think that if material is reviewed and set aside, I think there will need to be a process whereby you can go back and you can look at that again to see whether it has become relevant as the process has developed. But I think certainly rather than processing everything at the front end, there is merit in what's suggested there. I think that disclosure, it's probably wider than that. I think that easing the burden of disclosure is more to do with the changing the process, but getting the right IT in place. It's about reducing the huge volumes of paper handling that currently go on in the system. So we'd like to see all those elements come together to try and make that part of the system more effective.
Well, making it more IT, does that still play with regards to Coroner's Council having an involvement in reviewing the disclosed material? Because you can understand my primitive mind tells me this is a practical application where there's something to look at, there's something to feel, to touch, to pile, systemise, and you can understand where the Coroner's Council would be involved in that and discover material. And I'm looking at sheds and sheds of piles and piles of paper.
Yeah.
Computerise all that. You've got one computer screen in front of you. Is there challenges in that?
I think there's ways for all the elements of the system to work together. I think the early involvement of council is clearly about trying to identify the material which is most relevant and prioritise it in terms of getting it processed, and then maybe coming back to the other stuff. I think some of the work that the police are considering around their IT systems and records conversion would clearly have the potential to assist that process as well. But it's really about trying to get away from what is currently a very intensive manual process.
Okay. I'm going to put out Doug Biddy.
Thanks, Chair. They've actually answered my question, so I'm okay now.
Okay.
No, thank you.
Good that way.
Perfect.
Chair. Chair, Bill.
Just want to ask, when you're talking about the costing of it, just on the back of Lord Chief Justice Declan Morgan's cost of proposals of being able to carry out the legacy inquest for 50 million over 5 years, does that include, or sorry, 10 million, sorry, does that include the PSNI cost as well? Was it?
The costings, we have been working with all the other agencies that are involved in the process. Now, that's the police, the Public Prosecution Service, Legal Services Agency, Attorney General's Office. We've been working with all the agencies who would have a role in relation to legacy inquests to try and develop costings to implement the Chief Justice's five-year plan.
Yeah.
At the minute, the costings we have would be over the five-year period about 45 million for legacy inquests and all the regime that supports that. We have refined those costs even over the last period of time as we have learned more from the inquest that we have put through, and we'll continue to do that. I mean, as more and more legacy inquests are processed and we get a feel for how they operate better, we'll hopefully be able to refine those costs more. But at the minute, that's where we're sitting.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any further questions? Alex?
Could I first of all apologise? I was delayed at another meeting. And therefore, it's very dangerous to ask questions based upon a partial presentation. So bear with me in that regard. So the new regime and the money that Peter referred to, that new regime won't be in place if there's no money released.
That would be the current position, Alex, yes.
And has the Chief Constable advised the British government, the governments, whether it's our government or the British government, let's say in the terms the Lord Chief Justice outlined in recent weeks, where he said that there was a legal obligation that fell on governments in order to conduct inquests, which was a very public and direct observation by the Chief, an accurate one. Has the Chief Constable advised the governments of the legal obligation and how your work in on the police side of this is going to be impeded in the event that there's not release of monies?
Well, in those terms of the specifics of how the Lord Chief Justice has said it, no, I'm not aware that the Chief Constable has made that decision, because this process is led by the President of the Coroner's Court, which is Lord Chief Justice, so he has very much taken point, so to speak, on that. The Chief Constable has been very vocal in the public domain in supporting the position of the Lord Chief Justice, both in the call for reform and also the call for funding. The Chief Constable has been very vocal with the devolved administration and and London in terms of funding for legacy generally. We've made it very clear that these are all unfunded pressures. And, you know, we have made it very clear, for example, around the steak knife operation, that is unfunded. The Chief Constable has asked for funding and then asked for even just an assurance that if we get into sort of financial difficulties, that there would be an underwriting of that. Now, none of that has been forthcoming. But I mean, I can say that the Chief has, I'm confident that he is very vocal around these issues, but he hasn't made, I don't believe he's made the public statement to that the LCJ has made, other than to publicly support that what he said.
I think that's very useful to, in front of this committee.
I can't speak definitively for George, but
no, no, I appreciate that. But I think it's very useful to put that on the record. Would you, like, given the good work that you've done in relation to this new methods of managing disclosure, do you recognise that, separate from any of the other political issues that arise at the moment, a critical situation is going to arise at the end of February when Justice Colton reconvenes a preliminary hearing in relation to the Ballymurphy massacre, the cases of the Ballymurphy massacre, and when he will have to, because the work that the High Court is doing in that regard, in that inquest, preliminary work, is being funded from their own resources, not from any additional funds. Mm-hmm. Does the police recognise that, independent of any other situation, that within 6 weeks, when the hearing reconvenes, the impact, if it is the case, that Lord Justice Colton is not able to proceed further because of a lack of funds to move beyond a preliminary hearing to the point of inquest, if the inquest had matured to that mm-hmm. point, which is problematic given issues about identifying and locating soldiers and so on and so forth. Does the police recognise that all the good work that you've undertaken actually within 6 weeks can have a very hard landing because of the impact that might arise from the fact that the High Court can't even proceed in that regard?
I'll let Colin comment on maybe the readiness for that case. I think we candidly recognise that this process, that the inquest processes and everything that's going on, be it the Ballymurphy inquest or other processes, is very damaging to the police service in terms of accusations of delay, accusations of cover-up, all the nomenclature that goes around this, which is why the Chief Constable, you know, is very keen that the funding and processes are in place to move all these issues on. So every time we feel generally that the issues of legacy and how they are dealt with and how they're perceived by the public and the role of the PSNI in that has a fundamental impact upon how we are viewed in communities today, by all communities. So yeah, we do recognise that, Alex. I think that's, you know, and that's why we are very keen to the whole of the legacy infrastructure to be moved on in a way that has broad-based agreements, funding and support and processes that are designed to take some of the emphasis off us and also promote public confidence. So I don't want to be in the situation that you're
Let me ask you the very direct question. Should the failure to agree how to address legacy generally hold up conduct of inquest now?
I don't think it should. I mean, we have been given a schedule for inquests for the year. We're getting ready for those. We have discharged the majority of what we were asked to do last year. Colin can brief on that. So, whatever happens, we're keeping going. You know, we'll keep going with our Article 2 responsibilities. You know, that hasn't changed. I think what people are saying is that the process that is there, the criminal process that is there at the minute, isn't necessarily fit for what it's meant to be doing. But without it changing, of course, Alex, you know, the police service has to continue to discharge its duty, and we will do so. I don't know if you want to mention, Colin, about where we are for this year.
Yeah, well, what I was going to say was, you know, in terms of working particularly with the coroner service and this collaborative approach, and since, obviously, we don't have this five-year plan up and going at the minute, what we've been doing is we've been working with the coroner's teams, and I think through 2016, the end of 2015, through 2016, we've actually got I'm including one non-legacy case there, it was quite a big case, 6 legacy cases completed during that period of time. We've got another 3 legacy cases listed in the early course of this year. And, you know, that means we're putting focused resource onto these various cases in collaboration with the court teams. And we're getting these things done where we have the focus resource. I mean, obviously, the issue of Ballymurphy, Mr. Justice Colton made the comment about Ballymurphy. Our people did a lot of work in Ballymurphy, and there was a lot of material produced in Ballymurphy.
Some of it very late on before the preliminary hearing.
The day
before the preliminary hearing.
And this is why I'm saying, you know, this focused, you know, we have finite resource. There were 56 of these legacy inquests. And the whole point that's caught up in this report by Brendan's team, you know, the issue of prioritisation. This is something we pushed very, very hard because we've got a finite resource. We've got 56 of these legacy inquests. We have a limited number of people to deal with thousands and thousands of documents. But when it's focused, we can get these things done.
Can I just go back and clarify your answer?
Sure.
Irrespective of the ongoing legacy work, should the proposals of the Lord Chief Justice, the five-year programme, should that work be held up now because of the failure to agree wider legacy arrangements? Or should that work, which is a legal obligation, proceed now without prejudice to what does or does not happen in respect of any wider legacy discussion?
Well, if the question is, do we think it should proceed, then clearly, I mean, we are at the behest of the coroner. We will follow what he is asking us to do. We want to get the cases moved forward. You know, there's no lack of appetite to get the cases moved forward. I think it's in the interests of our community that these matters are moved on. So certainly I think the LCJ wants to get them moving along. So I think the Chief Constable's position would be entirely that let's keep them moving.
I think the Chief Justice and the Minister have both said on previous occasions that the delivery of the legacy inquest within the five-year plan requires the funding to be made available. If the funding isn't being made available, yes, we will continue to deliver inquests where we are at the minute, but it'll be at an unacceptably slow pace. The likelihood of delivering the inquest within the 5 years is just not going to happen.
So let me ask the question once more. Is it the view of the police that, given the legal obligation in relation to inquests and given the Lord Chief Justice's proposals over a five-year period, is it your view that they should proceed now, even if it is the case that wider legacy arrangements are not agreed?
Yes, I think the answer is yes. I mean, we want to get on with the process, so the answer is yes. We think that legacy, I mean, if we set aside all the issues about what are going on, if we set those aside for a second, you know, we still think that inquests should proceed. Once a direction has been given to hold one, of course, absolutely.
Could I then move on to a different question? Thank you for that. That's very useful. Where does the security service and the MOD interface with the police when it comes to disclosure assessments on sensitive material? How is it done? At what time is it done? Does it wait until referred across to a relevant minister or the Secretary of State, or are they interfacing with the police at an earlier stage?
Let's call and answer on the process.
Yeah, I explained earlier just about, for example, you know, the sensitive material. Sensitive material PSNA may include, for the sake of argument, MOD material as well. PSNA may hold some MOD material. In terms of how we process that material, that material is caught within our section of duty to the coroner. So when we invite the coroner to view a bundle of sensitive material on whatever the inquest may be, the coroner will come up and view that material. That material may well include the MOD material as well as the PS9 material. The coroner will deem that material relevant, so that will be the PS9 material and the MOD material. What we will do is we will speak to MOD colleagues and indicate to them that the coroner has deemed this material relevant. The coroner wants this material disclosed. Do you have any issues in this material which may attract any Article 2 issues or indeed maybe some MOD PII issues? Now, if they say yes, we do, and they mark it up, you know, say for the sake of argument for PII, They will take that material to their own minister in the Ministry of Defence. They will get their own PI certificate. That certificate then will come back and be presented at the PI hearing I was talking about earlier, and that will be examined by the coroner, and the coroner will go through that certificate like he will go through the PSNI certificate, and it will either agree it or not.
So where does the security service come into the picture? Is it that when you are doing your initial assessments, you are having a conversation with the security service about, do they have a view in relation to that redaction or that?
No, in terms of the example that I've just given, in terms of PSNI sensing material and MOD sensing material, the security service will not come into the picture there. The issues on PII and the PSNI material is a matter for the PSNI. The MOD material is a matter for the MOD.
Have you had any difficulties in, say, when you've been looking at PSNI papers, that you think that, actually, we think there's papers over there with the security service or with the army in relation to an inquest that's been conducted? Have you had any difficulty where you think there must be some information over with the security service of the MOD, difficulty in actually saying, is there anything over there that you need to be looking at and sharing with us?
Well, what inevitably you'll find will happen when the coroner and the coroner's team view this material and sense the material, whoever it's from, they will obviously review it, read through it. And indeed, what inevitably happens when somebody reads the material, they say, well, do you see where it refers here to, an attachment or whatever it may be? If it appears that attachment may be, for whatever reason, hasn't been copied there, the coroner's counsel will ask, could you go off and search to see if that attachment is there? Does that attachment belong to MOD or indeed anyone else? Could you ask? We will do that. The whole process is open and transparent to that extent. What the coroner will generally do is, if we have MOD material that's held by PSNI, the coroner will speak to the MOD as well and say, will you search? Do you have any material falling out of this PSNI material that the PSNI hold? Is there any further material that you hold? Or indeed, is there any other material you hold generally? And that will apply to any agency. The coroner has the ability to do that.
I'm sure one way or the other we'll come back to this. But could I just ask you one other question? Somebody said to me that one of the big reasons for delay is how and when and how often the Crown Solicitor's Office gets brought into all of this.
Yes.
Is that getting dealt with by these proposals, or is that a separate issue? And is there an issue there about this might be an indelicate way of putting it, but an overreaching role of the Crown Solicitor?
Maybe get called out, because this was just before, what the role of the CSO is for us, because they effectively are. We have legal services branch doing our legal work. The CSO are acting for us as our solicitors for this. So maybe, Colin, if you explain that and why they do it. And then, like all the recommendations and everything in the report, we're up for looking at this and examining this. We're not going to just preserve the status quo. But Colin, you explain it.
I think really where the difficulty in all this comes is the fact, that's absolutely right, Mark. The CSO are front-facing our legal representatives, that they will obviously be front-facing in the courts and in these legacy inquests. And the rationale for that, there's a couple of issues that are pertinent. Obviously, the CSO, with some of these matters, you will have various agencies that will be involved right through maybe one of these cases. So you'll have different agencies, and more often than not, the CSO will be acting for all of those agencies within the content of those papers in that one case. So there are issues there about interaction between the different agencies to make sure that, for example, Article 2 redactions that are running through, that are consistent, that approaches are consistent, that there are various other issues, maybe PI issues, that are consistent, or whatever it happens to be. The other issue too is, because of the volume, the sheer volume and the amount of material there are involved in these cases, the number of these cases, but not only do the police within legacy, you deal with the legacy inquests, but we also deal with all the legacy litigation coming out of the inquests as well, which obviously generates its own discovery processes. and its own process. So the work is multiplied and duplicated. And simply, you know, within the body of legal representatives within the police, there isn't enough people to be able to be front-facing in a court, you know, for all of these cases, because we're too busy trying to manage these other processes, you know, in terms of the PII, producing the disclosure, getting the disclosure into proper order, doing all the Article 2 redactions, making sure they're correct, consistent, proper, right through all of these processes. And simply, there's just enough, not enough bodies to be able to do it.
Thank you, Chair.
Okay, thank you. A question for me then, just finishing up. Obviously, the five recommendations for the PSNI, four of them are time-bound. Mm-hmm. And whilst we had the conversation, Mark, about, you know, giving you a chance to assess the report and speak in a corporate sense with the organisation, you know, three of them is end of this financial year. Now, some of that's, you know, review a thing or such thing. The other one is the 18 months, and that's the one you talked about, the technology transfer. Notwithstanding the Christmas parade, and notwithstanding the fact that you still have to speak to your people and in a corporate sense, are they still realistic?
I'm not sure that they are, you know, in terms of, you know, 18 months for the IT, you know, money, procurement, implementation is very tight. You know, but we've been talking about a lot of these issues now for more than 18 months because of some, you know, aspirations that this we would have had funding and so forth before this. So there are three 18 months around procurement and so forth. In terms of the other stuff, yes, I mean, for example, before the end of the financial year, we could certainly review our position in terms of applying security classifications. Changing the position is the next question, but certainly reviewing it, that can be done by then. We can certainly work with the court service about seeing, can we establish a single process with coroner's counsel for pagination and so forth. Those, I think, certainly the footholds of that are easy to get into, and we're very happy to respond to that. Us applying an admin team by the end of March, additional resources, no, I don't believe that's achievable in the time scales for the reasons I outlined earlier in my evidence. So it's not that we're going to ignore them, but it is, you know, we're really talking about 10 weeks, you know, in real terms for stuff that in some respects is quite fundamental. I think throughout all the recommendations, there's stuff that we will definitely get traction with. There's just other elements of it, particularly that issue about us and our risk appetite needs to be a longer conversation.
And it's my fault because I should have asked Brendan the question of why did he timeline them so tight. Is there in your eyes, and any Peter, you're sort of including this too, is there a reason why there seems to be this cliff edge of 16-17 financial year? Is there something obvious that we're not?
No, I don't believe so. I mean, I think it's probably just a case of trying to keep momentum behind the reform programme.
I do think, you know, in the interests of families and victims and public, you know, momentum and energy is key, and, you know, we don't want to drag our heels either, Chair. I think we all felt a year ago we might be in a different place by now, and that hasn't happened. But that doesn't mean, to come back to Alex's point, that we just shouldn't get on with what we have. It also doesn't mean that the Chief Constable does have the discretion, if he wishes, to apply additional resource and funding into this, but he's under, as you well know, colossal pressure in other areas. So that's that fine balance that we'll strike all the time, Chair.
Okay, that's enough. No further questions. Thank you very much for
your time. Thank you.
And Peter, I don't know if this is the right forum, but I don't know if I get another forum or another chance to do this. But I know we've heard the news about Ronnie's departure from your organisation to another one. And if you could, if it's possible, could you pass on the regards of myself and this committee to Ronnie? And we recognise the work that he's done within your organisation. And we wish him all the best in his future endeavours.
I certainly work well, Chair. Thank you.
Thank you,
Chair.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Almost time. We'll get to the pier.
Members, pushing on then. Agenda item number 6, legislative consent motion, criminal finances bill. I refer members to pages 147 to 178 of the meeting pack for the relevant papers. Can I remind members that at the meeting on the 8th of December, the committee agreed that it was content with the Department of Justice proposal to extend provisions in the Criminal Finances Bill to Northern Ireland by way of the Legislative Consent Motion. Can I advise members that the Department laid the LCM in respect of the bill on the 6th of January 2017 and has included two additional proposals not considered by the committee. The first new proposal relates to detained money and will broaden the circumstances in which a court may order detained money to be paid in satisfaction of a confiscation order. And the second proposal relates to free property and will improve safeguards for individuals who are subject to recovery proceedings. Further details of the additional proposals are set out in points I and J on pages 149 of the meeting pack. Could I ask members if they are content with the proposals to extend provisions in relation to detained money and free property aspects in the Criminal Finances Bill to Northern Ireland by way of the LCM, or whether any further information is required on those issues? Okay. Can I ask members then if they are content? I put the question to support the Minister of Justice in seeking the Assembly's endorsement of the LCM. And I put the question then that this Assembly endorses the principle of the extension to Northern Ireland of the provisions of the Criminal Finances Bill as amended at Public Bill Committee stage in the House of Commons, dealing with the proceeds of crime as contained in Part 1 and some minor and consequential amendments in Part 4. Agreed? I'll take that then as an agreement. Okay. No other comments on that. We'll move on then. Agenda item number 7 is an SR 2016/405, the Magistrates Court's Licensing Amendments Rules, Northern Ireland 2016. Can I refer members to pages 179 to 186 of the meeting pack? Remind members that at the meeting on the 13th of October, the committee agreed that it was content with the proposal for a statutory rule to amend Part 3 of the Magistrate Court's Licensing Rules, Northern Ireland 1997, which governed practice and procedure regarding renewal of a licence in the Magistrate Courts, including the documents to be lodged with applications or produced to the court. The amendments are required as a consequence of provision made by the Licensing Act, Northern Ireland 2016, for outdoor stadia, designated as being of importance to the whole of Northern Ireland, to renew a licence to sell liquor. The Department of Communities brought regulations into force on the 1st of September 2016, designating the National Football Stadium at Windsor Park and the Irish Rugby Football Union Stadium at Ravenhill Park as such stadiums. Can I advise members that the statutory rule was laid by the Department of Justice on the 25th of November 2016 and is subject to the negative resolution procedure? There have been no changes to the policy content since ASL 1 was considered by this committee, and the examiner of statutory rules has confirmed that she has no issues to raise with regards to the technical aspects of the rule. So can I ask members if they are content with the statutory rule? If the committee is content, I put the question that the Committee for Justice considered SR 2016/405, the Magistrates Court's Licensing Amendment Rules, Northern Ireland 2016, and has no objections to the rule. Agreed? Okay, agreed. Agenda item number 8, SR 2016/413, the Police Service of Northern Ireland Promotion Amendment Regulations 2016. I refer members to pages 188 to 194 of the meeting pack. Can I remind members that at the meeting on the 15th of September, the committee agreed that it was content with a proposal for a statutory rule to make changes to PSNI promotion regulations to enable it to participate in a revised fast-track promotion scheme overseen by the College of Policing for constables deemed suitable by the Chief Constable for a more rapid access to the higher ranks within policing? Can I advise members that the statutory rule was laid by the Department of Justice on the 30th of November 2016 and is subject to the negative resolution procedure? There have been no changes to the policy content since SL1 was considered by this committee, and the examiner of statutory rules has confirmed that she has no issues to raise with regards to the technical aspects of the rule. So can I ask members if they are content with the statutory rule? If so, I will put the question. Okay. That the Committee for Justice considered SR 2016/413, Police Service of Northern Ireland Promotion Amendment Regulations 2016, and has no objections to the rule. Agreed? Agenda item number 9 then is SL1, the Postal Administration Rules, Northern Ireland 2016/17, sorry. Refer members to pages 196 to 199 of the meeting pack. Can I advise members that the Department of Justice is proposing to make a statutory rule that will be subject to the negative resolution procedure to provide the procedure for a special postal administration regime to ensure the continuance of a universal postal service in the event that a company providing that service is at risk of entering insolvency proceedings as required by the Postal Services Act 2011. Under the standard administration process, the primary focus is on obtaining the best possible recovery for creditors, but under the postal administration, the objective is to secure the continued provision of the universal postal service as required under EU law. Can I inform members that while insolvency service, a branch of the Department for the Economy, is responsible for insolvency policy, the Department of Justice has responsibility under Article 359 of the Insolvency Northern Ireland Order 1989 for making the rules governing insolvency procedure with the concurrence of the Department for the Economy. While the rules affect court procedure, the Lord Chief Justice must also concur. Can I wish to propose that the committee seeks the views of the Committee for the Economy on the proposed statutory rule before reaching a decision, given the Department for the Economy is responsible for the insolvency policy? Members agreed? Any comments at this stage? Nope. Okay. Agenda item number 10 is an SL1, the County Court Amendment Rules, Northern Ireland 2017. Can I refer members to pages 201 to 220 of the meeting pack? And I advise members that the Department of Justice is proposing to make a statutory rule that will be subject to the negative resolution procedure to amend Appendix 2 of the County Court Rules, Northern Ireland 1981, to update the scale costs payable to solicitors and barristers in proceedings in the County Court following a review carried out by the County Court Rules Committee. This is the first review following the increase in the County Court jurisdiction in 2013 from £15,000 to £30,000. The scale costs are used for privately funded legal services within the county court, and there are no direct financial implications to the department. Could I seek the views of members on whether they are content with the proposed statutory rule or whether any further information is requested or required at this time? The members content then with the proposed statutory rule? Agreed. Agenda item number 11 then is the review of the need for stocking legislation in Northern Ireland. We touched on this earlier. Refer members to pages 222 to 237 of the meeting for a research paper on the incidence and prevalence of stocking in Northern Ireland, and pages 3 to 6 of the tabled pack for a paper on the handling arrangements for the seminar and oral evidence. The paper has also provided electronically to members yesterday. Can I remind members that the committee's seminar on the issue of stocking and legislation in our jurisdictions with Laura Richards from Paladin as the keynote speaker will take place next Thursday at 1:30 to 3pm in the Senate Chamber. The weekly committee meeting will then take place immediately after the seminar at 3pm in room 30, with one oral evidence session scheduled on the implications of Brexit. Can I advise members that there will be an opportunity to speak informally with Laura Richards about her work in relation to the issue of stocking at lunchtime prior to the start of the seminar? So again, that would be very important, members, for members to get feedback and to actually speak to Laura Richards in a more informal way rather than the seminar. Could I ask members to advise the clerk if they are able to attend the lunchtime event and or the seminar, and I would urge your attendance at both of those, members. Do that after the committee, or do you want it now, Christine?
Whatever suits members.
Members want to do that after the meeting through email, if need be. Okay. Can I inform members that 16 submissions have been received in response to the committee's call for written evidence, and these can be accessed on the electronic PAC system via the review folder. They will also be placed on the committee webpage following this meeting. I must get that accessed. I'll speak to Christine after the meeting, but if anybody has any problems accessing that electronic file, please get in contact with us as quickly as possible. Can I advise members that it is proposed that the following organisations are asked to give oral evidence? Law Society NI, NZAID, Northern Ireland Human Rights Commission, Paladin, the National Stalking Advocacy Service, PSNI, Probation Board, Northern Ireland, Public Prosecution Service, Queen's University Belfast, Vicky Clark, who's a victim, and Women's Aid Federation Northern Ireland. Whilst Men's Aid are unable to provide written evidence, it has indicated that it would be willing to provide oral evidence, and it is considered that this would be useful. I certainly do think it would be useful. There seems to be a lot of people there giving evidence, but if you read through the event, which I'm going to come on to now, it'll become clear how we're going to do that and organise that. Can I advise members that it was also proposed that rather than taking oral evidence in the usual format from each of the organisations individually, an oral evidence event involving all the organisations, which will be structured, will be held on Thursday, 26th of January, in Loch Ness Discovery Centre, Oxford Island, and Craigavon, from 2 p.m. to 5 p.m. on that Thursday. Can I inform members that the proposed format of the evidence event is set out at paragraph 9 of the Senior Assistant Clerk's paper and is based on a structured discussion involving all the organisations and providing committee members with the opportunity to ask questions and explore specific issues on the following areas, and there's six of them: the extent and impact of stalking experienced by victims, the effectiveness and benefits and disadvantages of the current legislation, handling of stalking cases by criminal justice agency and other agencies, the need for and the potential benefits of having specific stalking legislation in Northern Ireland, with the views on stalking legislation in other comparable jurisdictions, and lastly, the definition and types of stalking. A victim of stalking who is content to give evidence in public will describe her experience and its impact at the start of the meeting. Can I ask members whether they are content with the proposed oral evidence event, including the list of organisations to give evidence and the format and indeed even the location? Yeah. That'll be enough. Okay, members. Could I also propose that the committee undertakes or plans to undertake a visit to Hampshire to speak to those involved in the Hampshire Stalking Clinic? The multi-agency clinic comprises specialist police officers, probation officers, a Crown Prosecution Service advocate, a forensic psychiatrist and a victim advocate, and addresses stalking cases with a high level of concern. Are members content that we action something out there to go and see how it works? Hampshire seems to be the leading light in all of this. Members content that we try and organise something, a visit?
Yeah. In principle, but although anything just yet.
Could I also add something at this stage too? We had met with Mr. Luke Bloomer earlier in an informal meeting to do with the Family Drug and Alcohol Courts coming into Northern Ireland. Roy, you were there. Pam, you were there. And it might be an idea in order to go over to England to see how these Family Drug and Alcohol Courts work. We could do that all in one go, save time, everything else, save expense. So if we're over there in the South England, we'll try and catch some of the people involved in the running of those and see ourselves just how it works and speak to them.
I would like to agree with that idea. There are a lot of prospects and benefits to everyone if such courts were introduced in Northern Ireland, and we should take the opportunity to find out firsthand.
Okay. Can I also say that written evidence has been received from a former stalker who wishes to remain anonymous. but if we could propose maybe that the individual is invited to attend an informal meeting with committee members to provide an insight into his behaviour. A short note of the meeting will be included in the committee's report, but that could be very interesting and indeed very powerful. He actually, whilst he's a former stalker, he actually wants to tell us what we should do that would have stopped him doing what he'd done. So it could be very powerful. So if members are content that we have an informal meeting. Okay, thank you very much. No other questions or queries about the stalking review in its entirety? No. Okay. Agenda item number 12, the proposed care proceedings pilot. Can I refer members to pages 239 to 246 of the meeting pack for the relevant papers? Can I inform members that the Department has provided an update on the family care proceedings pilot, which was established as part of a staged approach to reform the family justice system? The aim of the pilot is to promote decision-making and minimise unnecessary delay for children and young people subject to public law proceedings, thereby improving outcomes for children by achieving permanence for them at the earliest opportunity. Can I advise members that the update sets out the aim and objectives of the pilot, the key features and roles, the court and trust areas involved, and the number of cases included? A report on the outcome and findings from the pilot will be completed by the end of May 2017. Again, those pages are 239 to 246. Can I ask members to note the update paper unless any further information is required at this stage? Are members content?
Yeah.
Agenda item number 13, correspondence. Can I apologise? First of all, there's 20 items, but of course we've been in recess. Can I inform members that 20 items of correspondence at pages 248 to 342 of the meeting pack and 5 items at pages 8 to 31 of their tabled pack? Can I advise members that I will draw their attention to several items and they then will have the opportunity to comment on any other items of correspondence in which they have a particular interest? Item number 16 then at pages 302 of the meeting pack. Can I inform members that correspondence has been received from the McGurk's Bar Families Committee requesting an opportunity to speak with members of the Justice Committee and make a brief PowerPoint presentation on the new evidence uncovered as part of their campaign? Could I seek the views of members on that request and whether an informal meeting should be offered? I'm quite happy to meet in an informal fashion at this stage. Are members content?
Yeah.
And we'll issue the invitations when that has been arranged. Item number 20, at pages 342 of the meeting pack, I advise members that an invitation has been received to an event sponsored by Alex Atwood, on behalf of the Dispute Resolution Service on Mediation for Consumer Disputes on Tuesday the 17th of January at 12:30 p.m. in the Long Gallery. Can I ask members to advise the clerk if they wish to attend? Do you want to speak to that, Alex, at this stage? Or are you content?
Save to make the observation that they may have some advice for dispute resolution in this building.
They come in handy, do you think?
Mm-hmm.
We fast track that one. Okay, item number one then at pages 8 of the table pack. Can I inform members that a response has been received from the Department of Justice providing further information regarding the rationale and reasons for the decision to subsume the role of the Director General of the Northern Ireland Prison Service into the Director of Reducing Offending Post? Clarification of the terms used in the job description that the candidate is expected to reside with an easy commute on the Stormont estate. I think this was maybe Trevor, maybe raised this along with myself. Can I advise members that the Department has indicated that the Director of Reducing Offending Directorate was not an amalgamation of two posts? It was established to provide an opportunity to enable closer working and provide end-to-end support to individuals to reduce the risk of offending through diversion and intervention, rehabilitation and joined-up custodial services. In relation to the term expected to reside with an easy commute to the Stormont estate, the recruitment panel considered that this requirement should be included in the job description given the wider role and responsibilities of this directorate and its strong focus on operational delivery, 24/7 service delivery. It was not a relevant factor in selecting a successful candidate, and candidates residing anywhere could apply. Could I ask members to note the response unless any further information is required at this stage? Okay. Mm-hmm. Item number 2 at pages 15 of the table pack. Can I inform members that the department has written advising of the appointment of Mr. Ronnie Armour as the new Director of Reducing Offending. Ronnie, who is currently the Chief Executive of the Northern Ireland Courts and Tribunal Service, will take up the post on the 1st of February 2017. Like Ian, you've heard me speak to Peter there about that, and wishing Ronnie all the best in his new role, and thanking him for his previous role in the Northern Ireland Courts and Tribunal Service. Item number 3 at pages 16 to 21 of the table pack. Can I advise members that the response has been received from the department, providing the further information requested by the committee during the oral evidence session with the Minister of Justice and officials on the 1st of December on key justice issues and priorities. Can I inform members that the response covers the meeting of the working group looking at the domestic violence homicide review, the 72-hour rule relating to working overtime in Macgabry Prison, the standards for the recruitment and management of security service agents, parity of esteem for all traditions and identities within the prison estate, the rollout of the special domestic violence court listings arrangements, and the nutritional standard of the lunchtime meals provided in Macgabry Prison. I think that was maybe Roy had raised that at the time, maybe. Declan. Oh, why, the spam sandwiches, yes, that's right. Sorry, it was Declan, yeah. Okay, can I ask members to note the response unless any further information is required? Is that okay?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Item number 4 then is at pages 22 to 29 of the table pack. Can I inform members that the department has written advising that the Minister has recently signed 2 commencement orders that will improve the services provided to victims and witnesses of crime through the extension of the registered intermediary scheme to the Magistrate Court for a trial period, and the piloting of pre-recorded cross-examination at Belfast Crown Court for vulnerable and intimidated witnesses. Can I ask members to note the commencement orders unless any further information is required at this stage? No. Can I ask members if they are content to action the other items of correspondence as outlined in the meeting pack, or whether anybody has any comments to make on any of them? Or want to raise anything at a stage on correspondence?
Could I, please?
Yep, sure. Sure.
There was one from the Speaker's office regarding a petition handed in by Jim Wells titled Promotion and Protection of the Unborn Children in Northern Ireland, where the Minister has answered a written question to say that that wasn't the petition that was handed in. And just to take some advice on what... Is that of any importance, or should we be doing anything? The Minister has said that it was a combination of 9 separate petitions, all on different issues, collected over a long period of time.
Page 290,
yep.
In our packs. 290, members.
Mr. Chairman, could I suggest it's an issue for the Speaker's office as much as anybody else? I mean, what is we in a committee here about it?
Yeah, is there any specific, Claire, that you wish to...
I just don't know what the process is. Do you know, is the Speaker meant to be checking what is coming in? Or is an MLA meant to be checking what they're handing in? You know, if we're getting correspondence from the Speaker's office to say that that's been done and the Minister said that it was something else.
Yeah. Well, I suppose we've all handed in petitions of one sort or another over the years. And again, the system itself is you present it in the chamber and you physically carry it up to the Speaker, and if you can, and then basically the Speaker takes hold of it.
Mm-hmm.
I suppose from that point, the Speaker won't have seen detail, and for all intents and purposes, most of the MLAs won't have sailed through all of the pages of a petition.
If you're handing it in, maybe you should put your hand in.
Yeah, well... I suppose you take it in good grace at times, and you've, you know, a petition's a petition, I suppose. So I suppose when you're handing it in, nobody in that procedure will, the Speaker will most definitely not know at that point. I suppose that whenever he takes it on and he passes it on to the relevant bodies, it's either him or they that check. So I suppose it's for the Speaker's office. Whilst I have sympathy with what you're saying, you know, legitimacy of any petition, you know, should be something of importance. So I whilst I have sympathy for point you raise, it's probably the Speaker's office.
Brilliant.
At this stage. Any other comments on that?
Sorry, Chair, and if that was a valid petition, by writing to us from the Speaker's office, are they just writing to us for information to tell us that this has been handed in?
Yeah, it's a
is that all it's for? Should we write back to him to say that it's a belief now that this was an invalid petition? Should we just so that we tick that box? You're absolutely right. It's not necessarily his fault.
No.
You know, I'm not saying it is his fault, but certainly if he's going to write to us and tell us it's been handed in, then we should be writing to him if we've now found out that it was an invalid petition.
Mm-hmm. The letters that we get about a petition are basically courtesy and procedural. Claire, the information that you've sought is from a ministerial question.
Was another MLA had asked a question of the Justice Minister, and she had replied to it to say that what she had received was multiple petitions collected over a period of 13 years and 9 separate campaigns relating to lots of different things, and that's what was handed in.
Yeah. Well, do you want us to check the Justice Minister, do you want to write to the Minister to ask what action or what happens now with regards to that? How is that recorded or how is that logged?
Can we do that as a committee or individuals?
If we have the agreement. Roy and then Pam.
A petition is merely it's a lobbying exercise. What we've discovered is there's been some flaws in the numbers involved. There still will be some, I'm sure, a relevant petition amongst it. It certainly has not been presented in a proper manner. That's an issue. It may be an issue for the Standards Committee, but I don't know what the Justice Department can do, what this committee can do. So somewhere between the Speaker and the Standards Department, I would suggest the way forward. And what difference does it make if there was 100 names or 300,000 names other than they were misrepresented? That was the extent of it.
I don't think that from one moment the committee can do anything. Pam, do you want to come in just
before? Yeah, I was just to say, I'm just wondering, it's definitely an issue for the Speaker's office, but is it an issue around the wording? Because I think he does say received a valid petition. I think that's the word.
It's meant to be a petition, but
the Minister does.
So, I mean, if they don't actually
The largest petition ever received in Northern Ireland and quoted number of signatures.
What's the wording? Well, you might know.
There's very little guidance around this. It may be there needs to be better guidance. That might be the outcome that's needed.
Well, I think ultimately it's an issue for the Speaker's office.
I mean, it's meant to be a petition, and any petition you normally have a set of wording at the top of the pages that everybody's signing, not, did you say, 9 different petitions over 13 years? That's very unusual. I don't think it's ever happened before.
You can ask the staff in the committee here to speak to the Speaker's office and see if there is a procedural format.
I think, Chair, it's just for archive purposes, really.
Yes,
We're really talking about somebody dragging this out in 4 years' time, saying, well, here's the largest petition, and we haven't responded to saying, actually, there's a question to that, you know. So I think it's an archive issue as opposed to anybody having to physically do it.
Okay, members content?
Yep.
Happy enough. Okay. Any other member want to bring in up on correspondence? Okay, agenda item number 14, Chairperson's Business. Just to say again that we met with Mr. Luke Bloomer on the Family Drug and Alcohol Courts in Northern Ireland. Very, very good presentation. He's a trainee. He's training to be a barrister, and he's convinced that the Family Drug and Alcohol Courts in Northern Ireland is the way forward. Problem-solving concept, of course, which this committee has pushed very hard in the last mandate and continued pushing this mandate. So again, as I'd asked and outlined earlier, if we can get some sort of meeting set up where we can kill two birds with one stone, that would be very good. Okay, members content?
Yeah.
Agenda item number 15. Any other business? Any other business from members? Okay. Agenda item number 16. Agenda item 16, date and time of place of next meeting. Can I advise members that the next meeting of the committee is scheduled to take place on Thursday, 19th of January 2025? Thursday, 19th of January 2017 at 3 p.m. in room 30, Parliament Buildings, with a seminar on stocking commencing at 1:30 in the Senate chamber. And of course lunch before that. Okay, members?
Any changes to that will be notified then?
We will be.
Thank you.